from Denver, Colorado. My wife and I own a personal training studio called Urban Palm Personal Training Studio. I've been in the business, fitness business, for almost 30 years now. I've seen a lot in that period of time. The reason why I got into the industry personally is because I was doing what everybody else was doing in the gym. I wanted to be a bodybuilder. I wanted to be a big, strong guy. And I'd be in the gym working out an hour and a half a day, 4 or 5 days a week, split body parts, a lot of weight training, and then on the off days, I would go out and do cardio. That's what you're told. You're told that if you want to see fat loss, you've got to do a lot of cardio. They say if you want to see muscle gain, you've got to do a lot of strength training. Well, the problem with that is that you've got two competing resources, and you really don't see much of anything. The other thing I learned is that you can actually put the body in a very overtrained state if you simply do too much of any form of exercise. You really got to balance rest and recuperation with the appropriate volume and intensity of what you do. That's what I'm going to talk about today. I put together a training program that is so effective it only takes 2 20-minute workouts a week for you to reshape your body. The things I've listed up here. First of all, you can build muscle, lose fat, reshape the body, increase reserve capacity. Now, what do I mean by that? When you take a look at what a lot of cardio buffs do, people that like to train for endurance, they think that they're increasing their reserve capacity of the body, that they're improving their endurance. Well, yeah, to a certain degree, but they're not improving their reserve capacity. In other words, they're not improving their body's ability to handle daily activities to a much higher degree. There's a difference in that. And that's what we do with our training program. We can really improve what your reserve capacity is. In other words, most activities during the day, be walk in the park if you improve that reserve capacity. You can improve your sports performance, and you can do it in as little as 40 minutes a week. So, let's talk about that. There are three valuable components to put together in your exercise program, in my opinion. One of them is strength training. And I personally think that's the key to having a youthful body. You've got to have the strength training piece. And I'm going to talk about that at length in a minute. But there are two other things that I feel are very important to put in an exercise program too. One of it is core and stability training. Us in the fitness industry really have improved that piece, working the core, over the last 10 or 15 years. Back when I first got into the business in the early 80s, late 80s, early 90s, around there, our idea of working the core was working the rectus abdominis, which is the superficial muscle of the core, the one that has the six-pack abs. Well, we've learned over the course of time that there's far more to it than that, that you've got the deeper muscles that you need to work, and you need to train the body to use those deeper muscles to protect the lower back and some of these other things. So core training is really an important piece. And we as an industry have gotten much better about that. And I'll give you some ideas on how you can train the core. Another piece to that is stability training. As we get older, we tend to lose our balance. And I really notice it in my older clients that even just doing a basic squat or lunge, they really struggle with proprioception, body awareness, and relation space. So stability training is very important for that. Moreover, stability training is a necessary adjunct to a strength training program, in my opinion, because when you do a strength training program, once again, which is very important, you work in the prime movers, you work in the large muscle groups, but you're not giving as much stimulus to the smaller muscle groups that help stabilize the joints and connective tissues that work with the larger muscle groups. So you need to do some stability training. You need to work on unstable surfaces to improve that. I'll talk more about that at length. And then another piece is the functional training. And once again, I'll talk about that. I'm spending more time here than I really should be, so let me move forward. Oh, getting ahead of myself, hang on. All right, so let's talk about functional exercise. In the fitness industry, functional exercise came much more in vogue about the last 7 or 8 years or so. And if you ask most trainers to design a functional exercise training program, their idea is to do things in the gym that would mimic what you do outside of the gym to improve what you're doing outside of the gym, make it more efficient or easier to do. So let me give you an example on this. Let's say you work at UPS. And one of the things you have to do all day long is to lift blocks off the floor, lots of boxes all day long, do some torsion rotation, maybe sit it up on the top of a shelf. You tell your trainer that, what he would probably do is have you do that same motion inside the gym with heavier and heavier weights, thinking that's going to improve your functionality of that exercise outside of the gym. I disagree with that. Because first of all, you're already doing it all day long. That's the last thing you need to do is more of it inside the gym. One of the problems that happened with that is that it'll further exacerbate any of the muscle imbalances that you're already having from doing that particular movement all day long anyway. Some muscles get weaker, other muscles get stronger. And you're doing a repetitive motion all day long that really wears down the joints and connective tissues. It leads to a lot of problems like arthritis and tendonitis. And lower back pain is a big piece to that. So when you go inside of a gym, do that same motion, it's not helping. That's not my idea of what functional exercise is. I have a different definition of it. My definition is to do general whole body movements under load that teach the body to work as a unit. And I think there's some real value in this because even though you do a strength training program, let's say you do a strength training program, I recommend you do a strength training program, you're isolating a lot of the muscle groups. For example, leg press, you're working the quads, glutes, and hamstrings, the lower part of the body. Bench press, dumbbell press, things like that, you're working the chest and the triceps. Pull downs, you're working the upper back, biceps, okay? So you're working the large muscle groups, but you're not teaching them to work in a coordinated fashion. For example, let's say that you do a leg press over the course of several months, and let's say you get up to a 500-pound leg press. Does that mean that you have enough functional carryover from doing that leg press out into real life? Let's say you have to push a car out of a mud puddle or help doing that. Do you have some transference there? You do, because you've developed some strength, but you don't have as much transference capability as if you were to do some functional exercise in the gym to teach the legs to work with the core, to work with the chest, and to coordinate their force production capabilities in a good movement pattern that can translate into real life. That's my idea of functional exercise. So, as an example, when we have people do functional training in the gym, there are two good examples that we have up here. My wife, Sharon, is doing a wood chop. I'm doing a cable press lunge. And in both of those cases, you see you're getting the whole body involved. The cable press lunge, for example, is a great way to get, once again, get the chest, the core, quadriceps, glutes, hams, the whole body to work in a coordinated fashion without being very specific in any kind of movement pattern that you see outside of the gym. When I first started doing these kind of exercises, one of my draws to adding functional exercise, I'd say, to the routine, two of them. One is that it's a great way to get the heart rate up to work and work above the anaerobic threshold. But the other thing that I liked about it is that it broke up the routine. If we did just strength training exercises, it can get boring after a while. Your mind checks out, you're not going to get as much out of your routine as you otherwise would. I found that adding these functional exercises was a great way to keep the body fresh and the mind fresh. But I've also witnessed or observed over time how much benefit there really is to doing a functional piece to your exercise program. Because I did work with a couple of guys, came to see me, that were already very strong, 300-pound plus bench presses, strong in the legs, that kind of thing. But when I would have them do some of these functional exercises, they were all over the place. They had no real coordination. They had no body awareness. It really surprised me. And after a few weeks of adding the functional piece to it, they had much better coordination. They had much better body awareness, and they had much better physical capability outside of the gym. So, in my opinion, functional exercise is very good and very important for that. And if you guys want to know any more about any of these pieces that I talk about, ask the questions at the end of the show. All right, core and stability training. I talked about that a little earlier. I'll spend some more time on that now. Okay, first of all, when it comes to working the core, I like to look at working the core in two different ways. One as a stabilizer, and then the other as a prime mover in and of itself. And going back to when I first got into the industry 30 years ago, I was just as guilty as any other trainer. We worked the rectus abdominis, which was the superficial muscle of the abdominal wall. It's the one that when it's developed and you have very low body fat levels, shows the six-pack abs, if you will. So we like training it. In other words, we would be doing crunches, sit-ups, low abs, that kind of thing. And we were teaching that muscle to work. Well, the industry has really grown in learning about or what's around that area. You still have the internal and external obliques, for example. And then there's a muscle that's called the transverse abdominis. Now, when I first got in this industry and I took my certification programs, they didn't even talk about this muscle. But the transverse abdominis is a very, very important muscle to get to work for the core. What it does when it's engaged is that it actually acts like a girdle for the midsection. And it will decompress the spine under load. So let's say you want to do squats or picking something up off the floor, lifting it up over your head, any of those kind of motions that really can put that back in a vulnerable position. It's the transverse abdominis that really protects that area. So you want to teach the transverse abdominis to work. The funny thing is that when you do a lot of core exercises that work the rectus abdominis, crunches, sit-ups, what have you, and you just focus on a lot of those kind of exercises, you're teaching the rectus abdominis to be the stabilizer of the core. And you're not engaging the transverse abdominis. You want to have it going backwards. You want to have the transverse abdominis to fire first, engage and stabilize the core, and then engage the superficial muscles as you need more force production to keep the core stable. So in other words, when it comes to training the core, in a stabilizing sense, we certainly want to teach the transverse abdominis to work. And then we do want to get the rectus abdominis involved. We also want to get the internal and external obliques involved. And we wanted that whole area to, once again, work in a coordinated fashion. And the same thing comes for teaching it to be a prime mover. Another fascinating thing about the core is that's where all the power comes from. When you play sports, it doesn't come from the large superficial muscles so much as you would think. For example, coming back to doing a strong leg press, let's say you get up to a 1,000-pound leg press, and you're a football player playing maybe an offensive line and you need to push off. Well, once again, you have some strength there, but it's really the power that you get from pushing that guy off the line comes primarily from the core. Same thing with swinging a bat. If you want to play baseball, play tennis, throw a baseball, throw a frisbee, whatever the case may be, all your power, all the velocity that you put into that throw comes from the core. So we want to teach the core to work as a prime mover, and we also want to teach the core to work as a stabilizer. So when we do that in our exercise program, 3 or 4 exercises typically to work the core, and we work it both as a stabilizer and as a prime mover. Now when it comes to stability training, same thing, there's a lot of things you can do to work the core in that sense using unstable devices, but the example I have here with Sharon is she's doing an iso-squat lateral raise on a DynaDisc, an unstable surface there. And our intention with that exercise is to work the smaller muscles around the ankles. Let's say you like to go out jogging. The ankles are really exposed to a lot of the unstable surfaces on the ground. If you don't have strong muscles around the ankle, you could really sprain your ankle quite easily. And once again, coming back to my main example on that, you can do leg presses up the wazoo, you can do squats and develop the prime movers, but those ankle muscles don't get as much work. But when you do something like this, those muscles have to work harder to keep you on there. And if you work with some dynamic movement patterns, holding some weight, for example, doing the lateral raise, holding the weight, trying to squat, stay balanced on that DynaDisc, those ankle muscles have to work very, very hard to do so. As a matter of fact, you get done at the end of the set, 12 or 13 reps with a good weight, you feel a lot of fatigue around the ankle, not so much the other parts of the body, but you do feel it around the ankle. So that's one example. Another popular example is using a fit ball. And let's say you want to do a dumbbell press, you can do it on a bench press. And if you do so, you're working the chest and the triceps, primarily chest, triceps, and the upper arm. But the rotator cuff muscles, the muscles that are around the shoulder joint and the itself, don't get as much work because you're already on a stable surface. They don't have to work as hard. If you were to do that same exercise on a ball, you have an unstable surface. So now the prime movers still have to do what they do, which is lift the weight, chest, triceps. But the rotator cuff muscles have to work much, much harder to stabilize that shoulder joint process so that you can actually lift the weight. In other words, the rotator cuff muscles, just by using the fit ball, get more involved in the lift. It's one of the reasons why I like using it. I rarely use a bench anymore, even though there's benefit to that too. If you really want to isolate the chest in that case, yeah, do the bench press. It's good to go back and forth, but I tend to, over the years, really favor using the fit ball in this case. All right, and then the final piece of a good program, in my opinion, is strength training. Several reasons. First of all, it is my belief that if there's any one form of exercise that's a true fountain of youth, in other words, if you want to have the same fit body when you were in your teens and 20s, if you want to have that same kind of body, in my opinion, better if you do a strength training program in your 60s or 70s than you did when you were in your teens and 20s, strength training is about the only thing that'll get you there. I know I hear a lot of people say, you got to go out and run, you got to work the heart and lungs. Well, what about yoga? What about Pilates? They all have their benefits. Don't get me wrong, they do. But none of them, as far as keeping a fit, youthful, highly functioning body, works as well as a good strength training program can. I just don't believe they can. And here's one of the main reasons. We actually lose about 0.5 pound of muscle a year from age 17 and 18 on up through the rest of our lives. And that process actually picks up when we get in our 40s and 50s. In my years of training, I've noticed the stark difference, for example, of somebody in their 60s or 70s, if they haven't done a strength training program, even if they were active, compared to somebody who did a strength training program in their younger days. I've trained people in their 70s or 80s that, yeah, I was able to get some strength on them, but I would say roughly 10-15% improvement in their strength was about it. Where if I worked with somebody that did strength training in their 60s or 70s, there was a stark difference. A good example is I'm training a guy, been with me for 20 years, in his 50s when he started. I was able to help him get up to 1,000-pound leg press. And he's in his 70s now, he's still doing 1,000-pound leg press. Or when I worked with a guy that did a lot of running, played a lot of tennis when he was younger, never did any strength training, I could barely get him to do a lunge with 5 pounds in his hands after a few months of training. There was a stark difference in muscle mass that was kept in the body. It's known as sarcopenia. And it goes even deeper than that. I got a part here where I talk about fast and slow twitch fibers. If I don't come across that, somebody raise their hand and bring that up to me, because there's a lot I want to talk about there. But anyway, moving on. One of the problems I think people have with wanting to do a strength training program, and I'm with them there, is they see these guys in the gym that are doing multiple sets per body part, that they're spending a lot of time in the gym, because that's what they're told you need to do to gain muscle and to maintain muscle. Muscle magazines say it, even Muscle and Fitness, some of the Shape magazine for women. And when you talk to the gym rats, they say the same thing too. So you really get this impression that you need to do a lot of work to build muscle. That's really not the case. One set per body part to get the job done just as well, in my opinion, even better than the multiple set program that most people do. But you have to understand how the body works. First of all, the main goal that you want to do is you simply want to work hard enough that you get to the fast twitch fibers. There it is again, fast twitch fibers. What am I talking about there? Let me spend some time on that, because I don't think I have that later on. No, I do not. How much time do I have?
25 minutes.
25 minutes? Okay, I can spend some time on it. All right, so let me break down why one set per body part can work. We're going to go a little bit into the physiology and what happens with the body when you do a strength training program. First of all, you do need to know the difference between what are the fast twitch and slow twitch fibers. You also need to understand something that's known as the size order recruitment principle, And then the third thing that is really valuable to know is what's called the all or none principle and how they all interplay when you do your strength training program. They also interplay in everyday life too. It's just that strength training, we can really pinpoint what's going on. So, fast twitch and slow twitch fibers. First of all, slow twitch fibers, they produce low levels of force. They're able to do for great lengths of time. They're the endurance fibers. If you want to go out and do long bike rides, if you want to go out and jog, what have you, you're working with the slow twitch fibers. Fast twitch fibers, on the other hand, produces large amounts of force. They do in a short amount of time, and then they burn out rather quickly. As a matter of fact, when the body calls in play the fast twitch fibers, it's incredibly demanding on the reserve system of the body. We're talking about the nervous system, we're talking about the hormonal system, we're talking about the energy reserves of the body. It's very taxing on the body to call in play the fast twitch fibers. When you do, then you need a lot of downtime to fully recover from that. Here's the thing that I want you to understand. You could train the slow twitch fibers all you want. You can go on and do the long bike rides. You can go on and do the long rides. You can go on and hop on the cardio machines. Very popular in the gyms. You're working with slow twitch fibers. You're not going to see any more tone, any more definition, any more shape, any more structural stability. You're not going to have any better capability of injury prevention. And you're certainly not going to see any better fat loss than you do if you work the fast twitch fibers. So in my opinion, if you're doing cardio exercise to lose fat, for example, if you're doing cardiovascular exercise to increase your physical fitness, it's negligible at best. You really need to get to working those fast twitch fibers. And the cool thing is, you don't need to do a lot of work to get there. You just need to make what you do count.